All right, well, let's turn in our manuals. We finished up yesterday about page 51. We're going to go on to page 52. There's a question, says, is it really necessary to ask a person if they want to be delivered? I'm being told yes, and also that I shouldn't cast out a demon just because I know that it is present. That is not true, right? Yes. Well, let me put it this way. Let me be very specific. You do not have to ask anybody if they want to be free. It's that simple. You have been given authority to tread upon serpents and scorpions. You have power over all the power of the enemy. You can exercise that power at will, anytime, anywhere. You do not need permission. Because first off, if a person has a devil, when you're talking to him and asking them, you don't know if it's them or the devil talking to you back. If you ask them, do you want to be free? It might be the devil saying, no, I don't want to be free. So it could be a lying devil. It could be all kinds of things. So no, you do not have to ask, right? Many times, just as we see in Jesus' ministry, people with devils will do one of two things, but it will be very apparent. They will run from you or run to you. Okay? So if people run from you, they probably have a devil. If they run to you, they could have a devil. Okay? So basically what we're saying is anybody can have a devil. Okay? So no, it's you need to recognize that people need to be free. And it's not your choice as to whether they should be free or not. It is your duty to do what Jesus commanded, which is to cast devils out. It's that simple. He does not say cast them out of people that want them cast out. If that were true, there would be no sense in his telling the story of when you cast a devil out and it goes out, and then when it comes back, if they are swept and garnished but not filled, they'll bring seven more back with them. That would make no sense because obviously those people want their devil, right? And so the fact that he said that proves that you don't have to ask permission. And you can cast it out. And if they want their devil, they'll be seven times happier because they'll get seven more worse than the first one. So, yeah, either way, you're helping them out. So, now let's go to page 52 of the manual. You're gonna see as through this training, this is really very, very simple. We've made it so hard. Jesus did not come to set up a new theology. He came to show us the Father, right? And then, of course, his part was to redeem us and give his life. But all of his ministry was showing us the Father. And the Father's will is always that people be free. And so even wherever you are, you have the Spirit. And wherever the Spirit is, there is liberty. Right? Yeah. Liberty for who? The captives. Come on. Amen. Right? So anywhere you go, you should be setting people free. And listen, we have this idea of what setting people free means and what it looks like. You have to realize what you see as the church is not what God had in mind whenever he sent Jesus, and what Jesus had in mind when he said, upon this rock I will build my church. It says church in King James. The word in the Greek is not church, right? It's ecclesia. And it means literally a governing body, a governing council to establish and govern the kingdom from that place. That's what it means. And so it's a whole different idea. But anyway, beyond that, we have to realize that what we see is not the way he planned things. When we say church, people have an idea, usually based on their experiences. And that doesn't mean that your idea, what you see in your mind, was what God saw in his mind, right? We have to go back to what he was actually saying. And it's the same thing with deliverance. When we say deliverance, God meant, okay, get people free. Separate them from their problems, whether it's the devil, whether it's sickness, whatever it is. And then we have to realize that in our idea, we look at it and we think, okay, it's going to take, you know, so many hours and it's going to be a lot of yelling and people are going to be falling down or, you know, bring out the trash can so they can throw up in it. And that's not Bible, right? I'm not saying it doesn't happen. I'm not saying it couldn't happen. But it won't happen if you tell it not to, right? So really, a lot of times, most of the stuff that goes on is because we want it to go on because somehow we think it adds to the drama, which makes us more important. And so we want that drama. Oftentimes, I'm not saying I do, or I'm just saying people that do that, that's what they want. Most of the time, I tell, even before a meeting, I'm very specific, and I tell the devil, no manifestations, nothing. If you act up, it will just draw my attention to cast you out. It's that simple. There's no idea of, well, we hope we have this going on or hope we have that going on. I even tell God, God, I'd prefer not to have any manifestations during the teaching, during the sermons, during the messages. I prefer not to have any manifestations. Why? Because it detracts from the message. Right? Now, afterwards, there can be manifestations, and those manifestations should be people get healed, people get free, because that is preaching the kingdom and then demonstrating the kingdom. And so, but the other stuff, I really don't care for it. I don't like it. I don't care for it. If God wants to do it, He can, but He already knows my preference. Right? And generally, He works with you. He will go along with you. Listen, we have to realize we are here as His ambassadors, and a good leader, meaning God, backs up His leaders. So, in other words, if one of my leaders here said something, even if it was wrong, as long as it wasn't hurtful or something like that, that'd be maybe a little different. But overall, if they said something that was wrong, and then somebody come to me and said, hey, this person told me this, guess what I'm going to say? Yeah, I agree with them. I agree with the leader. Why? Because that's my leader. I'll back them up. And then after it's all over, I'll go to them and go, why'd you say something stupid like that? Right? But I'm going to back them up because they're my leaders. Right? God's the same way. Even if you make a mistake, He'll back you up. Why? Because He doesn't want to lose face in front of the devil. It's just that simple. See, we have this whole thing, it's all mystical and all that kind of stuff. You say, well, where'd you learn that from? My dad, my earthly dad. My dad was a cop. He said, you know what? Even if we make a bust, and it's not a good bust, in other words, it doesn't pan out, even if it was the wrong person that we arrested, we won't get sued. Why? Because we're doing it under the auspices of the city, and the city will back us up. Even if we do something wrong, they will back us up and then deal with us afterwards. That's the way it works. And that system of order is God's system of order. And it's the exact same thing. So even, you know, it's like people say, well, what if I get somebody healed that God didn't want healed? Really, you think that's a possibility? You really think you have more compassion for a person than God does? You've got more invested than God does is what you're saying. I think God's got quite a bit invested in people's healing, right? You didn't give your son to give his back to be ripped apart for a person's healing. God did. So he's got way more invested, you know? And honestly, even if that were possible, I'd still rather face God and go, yep, I'm sorry, I got him free. I'm sorry about that. I just thought that was your overall nature. You know, I thought I was in keeping with the overall intent of my commander. And so I set them free and, you know, they got free. Okay, you know, oh well, right? And see, people say, well, no, you got to know this, you got to know. No, you don't. There's all kinds of stuff in the Bible where people didn't know certain things and did certain things. Paul did things that weren't commanded. He did it. He even said in the Bible, he said in the Bible, this is me talking here. This is not a commandment of the Lord. I'm just telling you how I feel about it. And so there's all kinds of things out there. We have to realize who we are and why we're here. We were put here on this earth to expand the kingdom and to glorify God. Really, bottom line, that's it. And so anytime we can, and when we say expand the kingdom, we're talking about every time you get a person free, you have expanded the kingdom. Why? Because you have made the enemy retreat and now you've gained new territory. And that territory is that person. Now your job is to disciple that person so we can keep the territory and not give it back after we fought for it. See, you say it sounds more like military principles. It is. Two kingdoms at war. Right? The problem is most of the soldiers in God's kingdom don't know we're at war. If anything, we think we're fighting against the kingdom of heaven. We think that, you know, well, I'm struggling against God. Well, if I want to do it, it's probably not God. Well, whose side are you on? Are you born again or not? If you're born again, what you want to do is God. See, well, you know, don't tell God where you won't go because that's where He'll send you. What kind of Heavenly Father do you think you have? He's not going to send you where you hate to go. He'll ask you, do you want to go there? And you'll say, no, I'd want to go there. But if you want me to, I will. Right? See, that's the best way not to get to have to go there. Right? Just submit your will to His. And go, I'll go if you want me to. It's not my preference. But I will go. Yeah. Most people think they'll get a call to missions. And they'll think they're supposed to be a missionary. And half the time, it's just God saying, would you go? And as soon as you, as long as you argue about it, God will say, I want to know, would you go? All he's trying to do is get you to submit your will. And then once you go, okay, I'll go, he goes, no, you don't have to. So we have to realize God is for us. Philippians 2:13, it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Amen. The fact that you want to, that's God. That's not just you. You don't care. If it was you, you're talking about the you without Christ. You without Christ, you're only in it for you. Right? That's not, you have to realize once you get born again, his spirit is in you to cause you to want to do things. His love has already been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. That love is in there. That's his compassion. You think you love people. God, don't you want to see them healed? Yeah. How do you think you're feeling that? That's his love in you that you're feeling. That's not yours. That's not human. See? Humans look at a person in a wheelchair and all they think is, I bet I can beat you to the checkout stand. That's what humans think, right? God says, no, you won't, because you're going to stand here and talk to him until you get him out of that chair. See the difference? See, that's how people think. So we have to realize this whole thing is so, so simple. You look at what Jesus did. He didn't walk around and try to establish this new and different doctrine. He was just trying to say, look, who do you think you serve? Who do you think your Heavenly Father is? He knows what need you have. You don't have to go through 7 steps to achieve, you know, divine prosperity. You just love God and love people and do what's right. And when you do that, watch, his blessings will overtake you, right? Well, but you got to keep all his statutes. What are all his statutes? Love God and love your neighbor. Amen. That's all the statutes wrapped up in one. If you do that, you're fine. You ain't got to worry about it. But what about this detail? And what about that detail? You don't have to worry about details. Why? Because you're loving God and loving people. And when you do that, you will do to others what you would have done to you. And when you do that, that's what you're going to be, I don't want to say judged by, but that's really how you're going to be looked at. And as long as you do that, you will never be out of God's will. Never. I remember the first time I heard that from Dr. Summerall. He said, 50 years, I've never been out of the will of God. I'm like, that is impossible. I was raised Pentecostal. I know that's impossible. Right? It's just, but he went through and showed us what God wants to be in his will. All you need to do is have your will submitted to his. Right? And just know that you'll do what he tells you to do. And the best way to do that is love God, love your neighbor as yourself. Isn't that simple? See, it's not all. We think we have to know every jot and tittle, every little thing, and have to have it just right. You don't. Right? That's why many times, even in warfare, people don't get it because they're trying to work by rules of engagement. And if you don't know what the rules of engagement are, you're going to make mistakes. Right? And so you have to know the rules of engagement. Well, it's the same thing with God. It's the same thing with his will. Once you understand what it is, what his overall intent is, then when you're in a situation that there's no clear directive, you just go by commander's intent. What is the heart of God? Love God, love people. How do you love God? You love people, and that's how you show you love God. So if this person needs help, what do? You help them. Right? You say, what do you mean help? What kind of help? You mean you're talking about feeding them? You're talking about clothing them? You're talking about healing them? Yep. Yeah, all that. Whatever they need, you meet the need and glorify God in it. You see, this is so simple. All this stuff about, but what if it's not his will for this? Or what if it's not his will for that? Well, that's your first mistake. First, get in the Word of God and find out what his will is. Amen. He says, don't be unwise, but wise, knowing the will of God. And we know the will of God. His Word is his will. If his Word isn't his will, he's a liar. So he said what he meant. He meant what he said. And all we have to do is look at it and put it together in context. And it's honestly very, very simple. Right? But we've made it hard. Why? Because the harder we make it, the more we can use the excuse, I don't understand it, so I don't have to do anything. Let me tell you, it's better to make a mistake in the right direction than it is to do nothing. That's right. Right? The biggest mistake you'll ever make is to do nothing. So even if you make a mistake, because we all know God can take the things that, you know, we did wrong and he can turn them for our good. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. But if you don't do anything, he can't turn that. If you don't do anything, all you got is nothing. Right? But at least if you do something wrong, he can turn it for good. Well, how many of you know that if he said that, we got to realize we're going to do things wrong and he's going to turn it for good. So even if it's wrong, do it and he'll turn it for good. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm not talking about going out and doing sin, and hope you understand what I mean by doing wrong. I'm talking about, you know, healing the person that maybe God didn't want healed, right? That's what I'm talking about, right? If that were possible. Does this make sense to you? We have to realize God is not just God. He's our Father, right? And because of that, he also wants to be Father to other people. So he uses us to show them what having a Heavenly Father is like. That's all it is. See? And how many of you know that, okay, if God is a God of truth and he's not a hypocrite, Jesus said he called them hypocrites. He called the Pharisees hypocrites because he said they don't, he said, do what the Pharisees tell you. Just don't do what they do because they don't do what they tell you to do. Right? So he said a hypocrite is somebody that tells you to do something that they themselves would not do. Yeah. But it, now, is God a hypocrite? Is Jesus a hypocrite?
No.
Well, then, if Jesus isn't a hypocrite and if God's not a hypocrite, then not only do they tell you what to do, they have to live by the same rules they put down. Do you get that? So if they're going to live by the same rules, then Jesus and through James, Spirit of God spoke through James and says that to him that knows to do good and do it, does it not, to him it's sin. Well, what's good? Is healing good? Well, ask the sick person. They'll tell you real quick it's good, right? Unless they've been religiously trained. No, I'm suffering this for Jesus. He's trying to teach me something. Okay, what's he trying to teach you? I don't know. Then he's not a good teacher, so obviously you're wrong. Right? If he's trying to teach you something, you don't know what he's trying to teach you, then that means he's not a good teacher. Isn't he a good teacher?
Yes.
So if he's a good teacher and he's trying to teach you something, he should be telling you what he's trying to teach you through this thing. Right?
Yes.
Isn't it simple?
Yes.
That's what it made us. See, that's why the Pharisees, they didn't get it when Jesus taught. Why? Because it was too simple. Jesus even told him, he said, Father, I thank you that you have revealed this to the simple and the prudent, but hidden it from the wise. Well, what wise is he talking about? Well, go see what Paul said. In Romans, he said, we, thinking ourselves wise, proved ourselves to be fools. Why? Because they thought they were wise. Well, they didn't get it. They didn't see it. They go, who do you think you are? He said, what have I done to you? I'm just leaving you alone. I'm just healing people and setting people free, and you're all upset. And it still happens today. People still get upset. But, well, it can't be that easy. Why? Well, because I've built my whole life around this ministry of going in and counseling people, and they get mad. Why? Because you take it away. I had one guy that his whole ministry was built on defining the spiritual roots of every disease. Had an entire book out on it. I was on Sid Roth with him and at different times, but we were all there together. And he had this book, and he was up there touting this book and trying to sell it. And then I got up there, and we all had to watch each other while we recorded the broadcast, and he had to sit there And Sid, he loves a good fight, you know. And we get up there and we start, all these other people say this stuff, and I'm sitting out in the audience watching, because there was about 10 of us. When I say the audience, it was like 10 of us. We were all guests on this program on each show. So we were all, then they flew us all down to Orlando to record it. So we're all sitting there waiting our turn to go on the program. And so all these people are going ahead. Sid put me on last, because we'd already been talking. We'd already been out to a Red Robins and we ate and talked, and I was telling him, yeah, we can do this anywhere. And he said, anywhere? And I said, anywhere, yeah. So the waitress server came up to us and said, you know, can I help you? And Sid goes, are you sick? You know? That's not something you ask a server, because they can't be working if they're sick, you know? It's like, do you work for the health department? You know, am I in trouble? She said, no, sir. And Sid was like, oh. Because he wanted her to be sick, you know? And we couldn't find anybody sick there, and we started to leave and walk past this table, and Sid knew this lady that was there. Had another lady he didn't know. And the lady introduced, said, yeah, this is my friend. She came up. She's going up here to run some tests at the hospital. Sid looks at her and goes, wonderful. You know? And this lady looks at him like, you're weird. You know? He may be. He's a bit strange, okay? But he's fun to be around, okay? And he's all theatrical. Everything is amazing. You know, it's just funny to watch him, you know. But so he said, this is Curry Blake, John Jaleet Ministries, and he can pray for you and heal you right now. And he could, Curry? You know, I'm like, yeah. So I just said, well, what's going on? And she told us, I said, oh, yeah, we've seen that healed a bunch of times. No problem, watch this. And I said, is there any pain going on? She goes, yeah, that's one of the symptoms. I said, all right, so if the pain goes, you'll know you're healed. And she said, yeah. I said, all right. Took her by the hand, commanded that thing to go, commanded the pain to go, said, how's that? She goes, well, of course I still, well, actually, I don't still hurt. And then she realized it was gone. And it was just, it was good. And Sid was excited. And so then we went to his office, and he had me pray for everybody there and had me pray for everybody. And one lady there, one of his producers, had tumors in her breast, and we prayed for her. And then right then she went to the restroom and checked herself and came back. All the tumors were gone. So Sid was, he was pumped. I mean, he was like, yeah, this is going to be a good program. You know, so but it's he couldn't believe it was so easy and we could do it anywhere. He could see it. He said, I've seen that in church. He said, I've just never seen it on the street. You got to remember, this was in 2000, the year 2000, something like that. It was back before anybody was doing street ministry, before anybody was doing that stuff. When we first started, we were the ones pushing for that. We were the ones told people, this can happen anywhere. I'm as anointed in Walmart as I am behind the pulpit or anywhere else. And we used to go to the Golden Corral and eat, and we'd be sitting there, and people would come up, and I'd be trying to eat, and they'd come up, and we'd start talking. I'd pray for them, and I learned to eat while I prayed, because I got to where I couldn't finish a meal because people were coming up all the time. And so, you know, we've learned that we can do this anywhere. And we started seeing all these things that were built up. It was all religion. It had nothing to do with God. It had nothing to do with the Heavenly Father. And so we just started tearing these things down. And you know, we tried to make it where we didn't become sacrilegious in the sense that we didn't, you know, we wanted to make sure that we always uplifted God and that we pointed to Him, that we didn't make it. The problem is when things become so easy that it's easy for it to become common. And when it becomes common and you become familiar with it, you don't hold it in as high esteem. And so we were always trying to make sure, look, we can do this anywhere, but it's because God. God is good. He is God. And we need to remember He is a holy God. He's a righteous God. He's all of these things, but He's our Heavenly Father and He loves us, right? And so, you know, we just, when people say, you know, do I have to, you know, I shouldn't do this or shouldn't do that. We had a person the other day said that they're an intercessor. And that's what they do, which technically isn't one of the fivefold ministry. I'm not saying it's not important. It is, but we've elevated it, just like a worship leader. Worship leader written in the Bible. It's not the New Testament at all, right? Not against it, but just we've elevated to the point where, oh, well, we don't have a worship leader. Well, we can't do church. That's garbage, right? You can do it. You know, I don't care if you get a garbage can and bang on the end of it. You know, it doesn't matter. The main thing, you make a joyful noise unto the Lord if you have to, right? But the point is you worship God, and if you can't worship God without anything going on, you're not really worshiping. You know, you're just part of a concert. You know, I drive down the road, man, I worship God, and sometimes it's with a music CD, sometimes it's not. Most of the time it's not, to be honest with you. It may start with a song, and then I'll stop it and just worship, you know, and then I'll just talk with Him, and we'll just go back and forth, and I'll, in the middle of it, I'll say, what about that? What about that verse? What is that? How does that line up here? And then I'll spend the next 3 hours driving in silence while He's downloading stuff in me. And then I'll pray in tongues and bring it out. And so, but I worship Him, but it's not a matter of, well, I'm going to worship Him so that He'll give me this. That's not real worship. That's manipulation, right? Well, we're going to worship to create an atmosphere for healing. That's manipulation. You don't have to create an atmosphere for healing. Jesus created the atmosphere for healing when He took the stripes on His back. Right? You don't have to have an atmosphere. You're not going to get an atmosphere in Walmart. Or at least not an atmosphere for healing, right? You might get some atmosphere, but not an atmosphere for healing, okay? So you have to be able to go anywhere and do this anytime. That's the whole point. This isn't about how to orchestrate a church service to have a good healing service. That's not what this is about at all. This is about you realizing that anywhere you go, you carry the Spirit of God with you, and you can literally release Him anywhere, and He's always ready to work. He's always ready to help. He's always ready to heal, to deliver, to set free. It's just us that hold Him back, right? And the other person, I don't even consider the other person whether they have any input or impact, I should say, on what I'm doing. Why should they have an impact on whether God, on what God promised me? Right? He said, believers lay hands on the sick. That's between me and Him. That's not between them. That has nothing to do. He didn't say, if you get them to believe. He didn't say that. He said, if you believe, this will work. See, that's what we got to realize. It's not about their faith. It's our faith, right? My faith will always work for me, right? And if my faith works for me, then I can apply it towards you. You get that? You understand what I'm saying? It's not a matter of, well, my faith will work for you. No, no, my faith ain't. If I lay hands on you to minister healing to you, my faith isn't working for you. My faith is working for me, right? Now, you get the benefit of it, but you got nothing to do with it. You could be conscious. You could be dead. You could be arguing. You could, whatever it is, I don't care. Right? Now, it may be to the point where if you argue with me enough that I'll walk away because I don't want to get involved in your argument, and then you might not get healed, but it had nothing to do with whether God wanted you healed or whether he would have healed you right then. Why? Because God's not healing right then. God healed 2,000 years ago, and all we're doing is delivering it. Amen. It's just that simple. God isn't deciding. When you walk to that person, God is not deciding yes or no on that person. He decided 2,000 years ago, yes. End of story. Right? Now it's just up to you to decide yes or no for that person. Isn't that simple? That's why this has become a movement. It's because it is just that simple. So let's get into the manual here. We were on page 52, coming into 53. 52, we were talking about Paul's temptation. We were talking about his, when it says temptation, we're talking about the infirmities of his flesh. And then in 1 Corinthians 4:10, Paul tells of his hardships. He says, "We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honorable, but we are despised." You hear a little bit of sarcasm in that? I just hear a little bit of sarcasm in that. Yeah. "Even under this present hour, we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted and have no certain dwelling place. And labor, working with our own hands, being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Being defamed, we entreat. If we are made," he says, "we are made as the filth of this world and are the off-scouring of all things unto this day." You'll notice here, he's going through all these things that he goes through. Now, on page 53, it says in 2 Timothy 4:20, it says, "Erastus abode at Corinth, but Trophimus have I left at Miletum sick." And people say, see, right there, even Paul couldn't get everybody healed. Okay, first off, let's say that was true, okay? Because he said he left them sick, right? And if you look at what was going on, more than likely, and since it's not clear, we could say either way, but more than likely, this idea of sickness here had to do with physical exhaustion from the travels that they did, that he was weakened. A lot of other things were going on, we could see it. But let's just say he was sick. Let's say he got, caught something, in the travels and got sick. And he got sick and couldn't travel, and Paul said, "I left him there so that he could recover," and Paul went on. Let's just say that happened. Okay, does that deny the doctrine of the Bible? Does that change anything? Does one person's experience change our view of doctrine? Or do we say, okay, that person was not able to see the fullness of the blessing of God, but it doesn't mean that we change our doctrine, right? Because the doctrine is clear over and over again. God desires people to be healed. That is clear, right? So if you have an individual, no one person's experience should change your idea of doctrine of what it says, right? Of God, especially of God's will. I can show you another one. If you look at whenever the man brought his son to Jesus and the boy had a devil and he couldn't cast it out, or the disciples could not cast it out. And the man then came to Jesus and said, "I brought my son to your disciples because he has this devil, and your disciples could not cure him, could not cast him out." What did Jesus say? "Bring the boy to me." And he brought him to him, and he said, "You faithless, perverse generation, how long do I have to put up with you?" Goes over the whole thing. And then what does he do? He sets the boy free. Isn't that right? So now let's take that picture and put it to today. Today, if Jesus' disciples can't get somebody free, what do we do? Must not be God's will. Well, just because Jesus' disciples then failed to get the job done doesn't mean that it wasn't God's will, because Jesus got the boy free. So God's will was that the boy be free. So just because a disciple fails, that doesn't dictate that it was God's will for the boy not to be free. Right? Because the boy got free and Jesus set him free. So it was always God's will for the boy to be free. So the disciples' failure does not dictate doctrine. The disciples' failure does not dictate God's will. Just because the disciples fail does not mean it's not God's will for it to happen. Amen? So put it to today. Let's say Somebody fails to get somebody healed. And what automatically, what do we say? Oh, must not be God's will. Must be trying to teach them something. Must be some hidden sin. They didn't go into all that. Jesus didn't go into all that at all. He just said, bring the boy to me. And he cast the devil out. Boy got free. Isn't that right? So why do we do that? Well, because we're afraid of failure. We're afraid. We're trying to find some. Listen, if you go into people's past or you go into their history in some form or you go into something and you try to find a reason, what you're trying to do is you're trying to find an out for you. You're trying to find somewhere where you can go, oh, well, of course I couldn't get the devil out. Of course I couldn't get the person healed because this was going on. And you can't expect me to do it if that's going on in the person. So all you're doing is looking for an excuse for your failure. Rather than saying, no, devil, you will listen. Sickness, disease, you will obey. Right? Because most devils, sickness, disease, whatever you want to call it, Wigglesworth treat them all the same. But if you want to call it a devil, if you want to say we're talking about devils, okay. Most devils know. If a Christian says, all right, come out, and the devil says, no. Then automatically a Christian goes, well, we tried. It must not be God's will. And they'll give up. And they just walk off, and the devil laughs at them. Instead of they're not used to Christians actually going, what did you say? You said no? Oh, no, no. You don't understand what's going on here. We've already won. You're on your way out. See, it is exactly like a constable coming to the front door and delivering your eviction notice. Right? There's no question about whether you're going or not. It just depends on how you want to go. Right? You're either going to walk out on your own or you're going to be taken out. What do you want? It's exactly the same thing. So basically you're telling this devil, you're going to go now. And if he says no, say, okay, we can do this the easy way or the hard way. I don't care either way. Right? I prefer the easy way. But if you want to put on a big show, that's fine. But either way, at the end of the day, guess what? This person's going to be free and you're going to be gone. So you choose. Right? But most Christians don't do that. Most of them just back off as soon as it doesn't work. Right? And then they want to put the blame on somebody else. No, you have to be able to say, no, this is what's going to happen. Why? But to do that, you have to be like Abraham, fully persuaded of why you're there. What are you there for? See, we have to realize, even whenever Jesus faced a blind man, before they said, Lord, who did sin? Was it this man or was it his parents? Jesus said, neither. End of story. Right there, right? Well, but, you know, maybe there is a generational curse. Well, apparently the disciples thought that might be true, right? But Jesus said, no. And that would have been a real good time if there were, he could have said, but there are cases where you do have to do that. But he didn't do that. He said, no, but if I'm going to do the works of God, if the works of him that sent me, I got to work while it's day. Why? Because night is coming. When does night come? Whenever he died, when Jesus died. He said, I got to work while I'm here. I got to work while it's day. He said, night comes when no man can work. When is a time when no man can work? When you're dead. If you're going to do it now. No devils to be cast out whenever you go to be with the Lord, right? No sick to be healed in heaven. It's all right here. Now's the time. Work while it's day. Amen? Yep. And Jesus didn't go into his past, didn't go into anything. Just said, look, and just healed the man. He said, and we need that same idea with that same attitude, if you want to call it that. We need the attitude of, guess what? I'm here. He's here and I'm here at the same time so I can set him free. If we meet, this isn't by chance. If we meet and you got a problem, it's not by chance. I'm there to set you free. That's the steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. Isn't that right? So wherever I go, and he says, thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus. So if my steps are ordered of him, and I always triumph, well, no matter where I'm going to win. Isn't that right? When I get there, whoever I run into, it wasn't a mistake. God put us on the path together. He may have had to remind me of something. Yeah? There's been times before whenever late at night. I'll give you one example real quick. We were in... Where were we? We were in Sherman. This is before we actually launched out. This was in 97, I guess it was 97, early 98, before we had going full time. And my sister-in-law dumped this dog off on us as a big German shepherd. The thing ate like a horse. I mean, constantly ate. Sweet dog. It was a good dog, but it was dumped on us. Okay. And I was expected to feed this thing, and it ate more than all my kids put together, right? And it ate constantly, okay? So late at night, I remembered we ran out of dog food. And I'm just there at home, 10 o'clock at night. Why would I remember we ran out of dog food, right? Because number one, I can tell you it wasn't a normal thing because I didn't care about the dog, right? I couldn't have cared if the dog went overnight without eating. It wouldn't have bothered me one bit. I could have done it in the morning. Not a big problem, right? But for some reason, I remember that at 10 o'clock, and I didn't feel anything strange. I just felt like, okay, I got to go get this dog food. And so I went up to the Kroger's. There was a Kroger near our house. Went up there and got this 50-pound bag of dog food because that's how much the thing ate in a day or two. And so, you know, I got this big old bag of dog food. And I'm carrying this thing on my shoulders, and everybody's checking out because the store is fixing to close. And so there was a lady up there, and at 10 o'clock at night, this lady was dressed really nice. Like, she just came from some fancy place. I mean, she had a necklace on, earrings, nice dress. I mean, you could tell she looked like she'd come from somewhere, more than just getting dressed to go to the store. And so there's a line of people, about three or four people between me and her, and she's checking out. I'm standing in line. It's late, and I'm thinking, come on. I just want to go home, or get, you know, buy the dog food. You know, throw it out in the backyard and let the dog rip the bag open. You know, it's just because he'd have done it. And so I'm standing there, let's go, come on. And this lady starts talking to the guy that was sacking the groceries. And I'm thinking, no, come on, don't start talking. Just go. And so all of a sudden I hear her talk to this guy, and he was a young black guy. And she said, do you know Jimmy McDonald? You ever heard of Jimmy McDonald? And he said, no, ma'am. And he's just trying to sack the groceries. He said, no, ma'am. Well, Jimmy McDonald used to sing for Catherine Kuhlman in her meetings. Well, by this time, I'd already been watching all the A. Allen videos, the Jack Cohen, all that. So when she said Catherine Kuhlman, I'm like, You know? And so he gets all the stuff, and they start to walk out, and I'm trying to watch, and I'm like, man, forget this. I just put the dog food down, and I cut around and went out and followed him out, and he was putting the groceries into her car. And she started talking to him. I mean, she's witnessing to him. You know, just started prophesying to him. God's got a plan for your life. He's got great things for you. And started just going. I mean, I'm standing there listening to it, and this kid starts crying. I mean, it's hitting. And so she gets done, and she pulls out some money, gives him a tip for helping her. And he goes back in, and then, you know, late at night in a parking lot, you don't want to just run up on somebody, right? Not in Texas. Okay, you're liable to get shot. Okay, but I walked up to her and I said, excuse me, I said, I heard you mention Catherine Kuhlman, Jimmy McDonald. Yes, you know about Jimmy McDonald? I said, well, I mean, I knew that he sang for Catherine. Yeah, she said, well, my sister used to play piano for Catherine. And I'm like, really? So we're standing out there. Now the store's closing, the dog food's gone. I mean, it's, you know, but this was no accident. This was a divine connection. But to get me there, God had to remind me that the dog needed food, right? Now, I didn't feel anything. I didn't hear a voice say, arise, go to yon Kroger. You know, I didn't, it was none of that. It was just a normal thing. God had to look around and go, what is he out of that'll get him to Kroger? You know, he could have said Cokes. I'd have went there even if I wasn't out, right? So we're up there talking to this lady, and this lady starts talking to me a little bit, and she's talking about Catherine Kuhlman. Then all of a sudden, she switches gears. Now, she didn't know it, but I was getting ready to go to Africa for the first time. And she, right in the middle of talking about Catherine Kuhlman, she switches gears, starts prophesying. You know, I see you in a place where there's tall grass. I see this place that there's like these huts. It looks like it's made out of mud, but it's not mud. It's something else. But I see you in this place, and God wants you to know that when you're there, your life's going to be in danger. But he's going to protect you. She said he's going to protect you. Even if you have to walk on water to do it, he'll protect you. And he's going to see you through it. And I'm listening to that because I'm thinking, I'm going to a place of tall grass, you know? I'm going to a place of huts, and I don't know what they're made out of, but yeah, that sounds about right. And then I'm kind of like, let's go back to the life in danger part. What do you know about that, you know? And so she goes in, and we start talking about this stuff. And then we part ways. Well, kind of find out, eventually, over a period of time, we meet up again, and our lives intersect several times over about the next 5 years. And every time it's a divine appointment. And so, but later on that year, I went to Africa for the first time, into Kenya, into Uganda, over into Tanzania. And my life was in danger. I had When people tried to rob me, they tried to steal my stuff. One guy tried to pickpocket me. The guys that tried to rob me, they tried to get me out of the car so they could take off with all my luggage. And I didn't. And they were going to take me out somewhere and dump me off. And I don't understand Swahili. But I knew exactly what they were saying. And as far as I'm concerned, it's exactly what happened on the day of Pentecost whenever they spoke one language and they heard them. They're speaking in tongues, but they heard them speaking their language. So I heard them, and I heard them talking about where they were going to dump me, where they were going to take me out. And they didn't say they were going to hurt me. They just said they were going to take me out there and basically rob me. And I had this big card that was, probably shouldn't be telling this part, but it was a big card that said UN, right? And it looked official, but it was totally fake, okay? But it said UN diplomat, right? And so I had it underneath my shirt, and it was just a card. I had it undone. And so we're driving. I hear them talking about doing this. So I pull this thing out, and I'm like, you don't know who I am. I said, I'm from the United States. My president, where he will find you. He will bomb you. He will drop a bomb on you. You don't understand. You got to take me back to my hotel. And they're looking at me, and because they spoke English, but they didn't, you know, and I don't speak Swahili, but they knew I understood them. So they zipped around, took me back to the hotel. And when they did, one jumped out and grabbed my luggage and threw it out so that I would actually get out of the car. And since I got out, they took off. So at that time, I knew my president would not bomb anybody for me. But might have bombed me instead. I don't know. But then I had another guy try to put his... You don't carry a wallet on you that they can see you carry it around your neck or something. And... But they'll give you a piece of wood to put in your pocket that looks like a wallet. So if they try to pickpocket you, they go after the piece of wood and they don't get anything. Well, this guy put his hand, he came up behind me and put his hand into my pocket trying to get that piece of wood, thought it was a wallet. And because he was like this, that's the natural position for an arm bar. Yeah. And so I automatically grabbed his wrist and put him into an arm bar and put him on the ground. And then the Kenyan police come running up and they grabbed him, and they're not gentle, okay? I mean, they grabbed him. It's kind of like whipping a child. It's not bam, bam, bam. You just go around in circles, you know? And, I mean, they were beating on him, and they took him off. But anyway, so we had all kinds of situations. I had guys pull AK-47s on us in the church I was at, came in and looked for us, and God protected me. They didn't see me. It was like if I was hiding back here. I mean, you could see me, right? Well, that's what it was. It was these chicken coops that had these things, and you could see through it. And this guy came in. We were in a place we weren't supposed to be. And it was off limits. And so we were in there preaching, and then this guy got healed, and he ran out and started getting all excited and shouting it. And then they talk about the white healer, which is what they call you over there a lot of times. And there wasn't supposed to be any white people there at all. So whenever the government guys, the army was there patrolling the streets, whenever they came in, they heard about it, and they came in looking for me, and the pastor pushed me down behind this chicken coop. And this guy's coming in, walking around with AK-47s, looking. Our eyes meet. I'm fixing to stand up and go, oh, okay, you got me. All right. But before I did, we look at each other, and then he just turns and walks off. So he did not see me. And so then we jump out, and we ran behind this building, and we run down this alley. And as we run, there's this thing. It's a trough, basically, with sewage running down through the door. And so we were running down through there, and we get to this guy's house, a couple of houses down. His pants are wet to his knees. My pants are not wet at all. And all I could do is wherever I put my foot, I could see it would leave tracks of water. And the pastor turned around and looked, and he goes, oh, Brother Cuddy, look at you. The Lord, he do protect you. He make you walk on water. And immediately I remembered that parking lot. And then whenever that happened, I thought, you know what? Because, I mean, your heart's beating. People looking for you with AK-47s. Let me tell you, you never know what alive feels like until you could be dead. Okay, then you know what a lie feels like. But right then I remembered, and I remember thinking, right then, I know I'm going to come out of this. Why? Because of that prophecy back at that Kroger store. Why? I knew God was going to protect me. And after that, everything just like, oh, okay, this is going to be all right. You know, even if I have to hide, I'll be okay. I'm going to come out of this. Eventually we did. We got caught, and they took us back into Nairobi, and they, you know, went and got all of our stuff and took all my film out of my camera and all that stuff. So anyway, the only reason I'm saying that is actually, I'm not sure why I'm saying that. I don't know why we got on that at all now. But yeah, being led by God. That was it. All of that started because I was led. And I didn't know even when I was being led. So many times, see, we want to have this experience. And many times you're led and you don't even know you're being led. Right? So it's not about knowing you're led. It's about stepping out in faith. If you always know when you're being led, there's no faith involved. See, there may be obedience, but there's no faith involved. God wants us to walk by faith because that pleases him. And so many times you have to step out not knowing that what you're doing, whether it is exactly right or not, whether you are making a mistake or not. All you know is the heart of God is, I want to help this person. And so I could give you a bunch of other examples like that. We've done the exact same thing. Wreck situations, different things going on. I could give you all kinds of testimonies of situations where I can't say I heard God say do this, but we did it because it was the right thing to do. Right? We could help somebody and we did. So now let's go back. We're still on page 53 and we're out of time. So we're going to have to stop here in just a minute. But I wanted you to realize this. Even in Philippians 2, down in verse 30. Well, actually, might as well start in verse 25 and then we'll stop. He said, yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor and fellow soldier, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants. For he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because that you had heard that he had been sick. Now, isn't it funny? All these people around Paul got sick, but it never says Paul was sick. And yet the one thing we want to do is say, oh, well, Paul had a thorn. Paul was sick. But it never mentions Paul being sick. And all these people around him got sick, but apparently they didn't stay sick, right? Well, we'll see it here. It says, for indeed he was sick near to death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when you see him again, you may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation, because for the work of Christ he was near to death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. You hear that? Got a little jab in there at the same time. Okay? But notice he said it was for the work of Christ. So again, very likely it had to do with exhaustion, had to do with the things going on with travel. Maybe there was something. But even if it was, it doesn't matter because we heard he got healed. Right? So yeah, he was sick at one point, but he got healed. And so you can, the whole point, actually this proves healing. It doesn't prove that people don't get healed. It proves the opposite. Amen? So, all right, let's take a quick break. We will come back in 10 minutes, 9 minutes now, and we'll pick this back up. We'll start in section 7 and get back on track.